All right, at this time, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to start the service. So we do ask that you do please silence your cell phones. And then Pastor David, I believe, is going to open it up for shared time. So when he does that, if you could come up to the microphone to speak or speak loudly from your seats, that way the microphone can pick up the sound for the viewers online so they can hear as well. So, all righty.
Good afternoon. Welcome and thank you for coming as we take some time to honor and remember Chuck Scribner. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your goodness and for your love. We thank you for being with us through times of struggle and times of loss. I ask that you would be with us today as we take some time to remember a lost loved one. Give peace, give strength, give comfort, Lord, to those that are hurting. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to read a little poem to you before we open it up to some sharing of the memories. It's a little poem that I like to read. It kind of gives us a little perspective on life. It's called The Dash. I read of a man who stood to speak at a funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on the tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that the first date was the date of birth and spoke of the following date with tears, but said that what mattered most of all was the dash between those 2 years. For that dash represents all the time they spent alive on earth, and now only those who love them know what that little line is worth. For it matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we lived and loved and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. To be less quick to anger and show appreciation more and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect and more often wear a smile, remembering that this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read, with your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you lived your dash? Now, I didn't have the opportunity to know Chuck as well as most of you, but some of the things that were shared with me, I'll just kind of share with you. He loved fishing. He loved fishing, particularly in Brimley and Canada. He would take some trips, enjoyed mushrooming and berry picking. He was a fan of Elvis. His middle name was changed to Presley, I believe. He owned and operated a Scribner drywall business for many years. He cherished two dogs, Sassy and Patsy. But more than anything, he loved his family. Married to Diana for 51 years, and recently reunited to two of his children, and enjoyed getting to know them and his grandchildren. One of the funny things I heard about him is he always had a habit of buying two of everything when he went shopping. So maybe some of you can recall that. I want to encourage you, again, most of you probably knew him better than I did, to share any happy or funny memories or stories that you have of him. If you'd like to come forward so others can hear a little better, but if you want to just share from where you are, just feel free to speak up and do that as well.
Hi, everyone. Most of you know me. I'm Tammy. I'm Chuck's daughter, one of his children. Excuse me. I want to take this time to remember and honor the special memories that we've all had with Dad. I find as I get older, I become more sentimental, and family becomes even more important, and memories start becoming all we have. My biggest goal is for Dad to be honored and never forgotten. It's hard to summon up a lifetime in a few words. So I'll just give a few of my favorite. I like to call him Papa, but I'm going to read it as if I was writing it to Dad. So, Papa, I've been thinking about all the fun times we had. I remember you picking beans before I got home and me coming behind you and getting a ton more. I miss sitting on the deck snapping beans and having Aunt Nye and Darlene stop over with the dogs eating beans on the deck. I miss picking strawberries and you stretching out in the row, literally stretching out in the row, picking berries. I miss our car rides, our hot sauce contest as we dared each other to try the next sauce and pretty soon the sweat would be beading on our foreheads. Car rides looking for deer. I miss our visits at the nursing home when I would bring a bottle of pop and you would reach for it and take a sip and a sparkle in your eye and I'd ask, do you want my pop, Dad? He'd nod his head. Me pushing you in your wheelchair with my phone playing Elvis and other country songs that he liked, with the dogs on his lap and him grinning as we went up and down the halls. I miss your helpfulness throughout the years. You always wanted to help. I will always feel your love. I miss the concerts we would go to. I remember taking you and Mom to the casino to see Charlie Pride and you holding Mom's hand and smiling. I will miss you telling me you love me as I would leave. Dad, I will never forget you, and I will hold all our memories close to my heart. Thank you for being my dad.
First of all, I just want to thank everybody for being here to honor our dad, husband, uncle, grandfather. My name is Debbie Scribner. A lot of you may not know me. Our father, Charles Presley Scribner, came into our lives 26 years ago on a Thanksgiving weekend when I finally made that phone call because... Little background story, I looked for him for most of my life. Didn't exactly know how to find him. My mother wasn't very forthcoming with any information. So I just remember putting quarters in the, and then it was a payphone that you could actually put dimes and quarters in, and just called different cities in Michigan until I thought I would find him. But unfortunately, that didn't happen. Although one Thanksgiving, I did a people search on the computer, and I got a list of 50 names that was Charles P. Scribner. And I'm like, oh, geez, where was this computer 15 years ago? But I got a list of 50 names, and I'm like, where do I start? I didn't know where to start because they were in different cities, and I knew he was in Florida, knew he was in Michigan. But anyway, the very first one that I called was him. And I remember Diana answering the phone, and I said, may I please speak to Charles Scribner? And she's like, yes, hold on a minute. And I'm thinking to myself, what woman wouldn't question another woman calling and asking for your husband? But apparently he had the drywall business, so there was no question there. And I remember asking him a few questions just to make sure that it was him. And he kept asking me, well, who is this? And finally I told him, I said, well, my name is Debbie, and I would be your daughter. And he was very happy to know that. And he said, well, I'll be. And I immediately, like after we hung up, I called Chuck Jr. and said, you'll never guess who I got off the phone with. And I told him, and I gave him the number. He called him, and then he called me back, and he said, you know what? It's funny. I remembered his voice. We were very young. Our parents were very young whenever they met, and you know how that goes. Things don't work out whenever you meet that early that young at age. But my dad and our dad and stepmother decided to make a trip to Pittsburgh that following weekend. And those are the pictures that you may have seen on the slideshow back there. I am forever grateful that he was found, and everybody has been a part of our lives. I've met cousins and nephews, and I have a wonderful sister and brother out of the deal. It's been a blessing, and our dad talked to us like, okay, so here you are. Let's do life. So Thanksgiving time became a tradition for us because that was the time that he was found. So every Thanksgiving, we would always get together with family, and it was the most loving, special time I could ever think of. And I am forever grateful for having him in our lives, my life especially. I'm speaking for myself, for the 26 years that we did. My children, especially Jessie, who's in the back, have a lot of fond memories of him going fishing with Uncle Lowell at Houghton Lake and having a fish fry right after. We went to Kokomo's and with the kids all the time and played the video games. You remember? Yep. And going bowling. I have plenty of pictures of those too. And I am I just want to say that I'm very thankful that I got to meet him and know him. And I was here in May and got to see him one last time. And I was able to say some things to him that I needed to say for myself. Not that he really knew what was going on, but I just was appreciative of those times. And I don't know, I love him very much. And I wasn't sure if I even was able to share a lot of memories that I have with him, but when we were driving up here, I kept thinking, oh, well, there's that. And we did that. And I did, oh, we did that too. So the memories, cherish your memories with your loved ones. Because in the end, that's pretty much all you have left, right? And love each other. Thank you very much. I'm sorry.
I'll make this short. I've enjoyed that we met them, and they call me Mom and Dad. Yeah, and so it's been a lot to me. I've really loved them. I just wish they could have seen him sooner, but we all make mistakes. But he was really happy that he got reunited. And I was happy for him, and I've enjoyed it too.
Well, I remember when I first spoke to you again, when I spoke to you again on the phone, and you said we have a lot of room in our hearts and a lot of love in our hearts. After so many years, you know? So I appreciate you. I do.
I've always talked about the children, down through the years.
I remember him saying, I just want to hug around the neck.
Afternoon, everyone. Jack Scribner, Jr. And that phone call, I had to share my part of it. I was sitting there after my sister called. My kids were sitting there. What am I going to say to this guy after all this time? Look at him. I call him up. Is this Chuck Scribner? He goes, yes, it is. I said, well, this is Chuck Scribner. How the hell you been? And I kind of broke the ice. And we got to talking, and I told him, if it's a bad time, or not supposed to be, let's say our goodbyes, and now. But it was, excuse me. No, we're going to get together, and very next weekend. You guys come down. Yeah. It was beautiful. Yeah. So you think you shouldn't take that chance. Take it. You'll never know. Right. Yeah. So thank you.
Anyone else like to share any memories? I'm sure.
But I don't think everybody has that
much time. You kind of took the words out of my mouth already. I was going to say, you know, sharing the memories are a key point. Mm-hmm. You know, hanging on to that cherished memory. You know, there's the loss is always very real, but those memories and the happy times are what's going to carry you through that. So make sure to continue to share those memories with each other that you have. I want to share some hope in Scripture with you. We are not alone. We have someone we can go to in times of struggles and trials. I might ask you to read some of these Scriptures. Psalm 46 says, God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. God will be a constant through the storm. God has a great love for us. Some of you may know John 3:16, but I love the follow-up verse I was asked to read is 17 as well. For God so loved the world that he gave his only, one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Jesus, talking with his disciples, gave us some hope about what we can look forward to. In John chapter 14, first through verses, Jesus says, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust also in me. There is more than enough room in my Father's home. If this were not so, would I have told you that I am going to prepare a place for you? When everything is ready, I will come and get you so that you will always be with me where I am." We put our hope and faith in Jesus. We have a home waiting for us for when we pass on from this earth. I was also asked to read Psalms 23. Someone else was going to read that, but they couldn't make it, so I'm going to read it for them. Psalms 23, "The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Of talking about the house of the Lord, that heaven that we can look forward to, I want to share another poem from some of you may know Bonnie Allen, and if you know some of the poems that she writes, I love this one. I kept it from one that she wrote for someone else's service. It's called Gone Home. Weep not, my loved ones. Be not sad. I bid you fond adieu, for though I've moved from earth to heaven, I'll still watch over you. My love will not diminish, though you see no more my face. I've simply changed my address to a far, far better place. Rejoice with me and praise the Lord. Though earth no more I'll roam, new fields I'll be exploring, for my Father's called me home. This earth was not my home, you see. I merely passed this way. Now I've gone home to my Father forevermore to stay. I know that Chuck enjoyed sports in his life. It's baseball and boxing and some things like that. And I love the passage of the last letters that Paul wrote, forgive me, to Timothy. And he writes about this in the form of kind of like an athlete. He says, I've fought the good fight. I've finished the race. And I have remained faithful. And now the prize awaits me, the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me on the day of his return. And the prize is not just for me, but for all who eagerly look forward to his appearing. We have a hope beyond this life. The death that we have in this life is not the end. I want to read Corinthians chapter 15, starting with verse 51. Paul gleans some wisdom into these earthly bodies we have. He says, what I am saying, dear brothers and sisters, is that our physical bodies cannot inherit the kingdom of God. These dying bodies cannot inherit something that will last forever. But let me reveal to you a wonderful secret. We will not all die, but we will all be transformed. It will happen in a moment, in the blink of an eye, when the last trumpet is blown. For when the trumpet sounds, those who have died will be raised to live forever. And we who are living will also be transformed, for our dying bodies must be transformed into bodies that will never die. Our mortal bodies must be transformed into immortal bodies. Then, when our dying bodies have been transformed into bodies that will never die, this scripture will be fulfilled. Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? For sin is the sting that results in death, and the law gives sin its power. But thank God, he gives us victory over sin and death through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you for, again, your love for us. I thank you for the memories that were shared. Thank you for the life that was lived. I pray that you would continue to give peace and strength to this family and loved ones. Lord, help them to seek you out in their times of need. Help them to feel your presence and peace in their lives. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. I want to close with a blessing, and then there will be a closing song that will close out the ceremony. May the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace.
face the devil. You were no stranger to the rain. So go rest high on that mountain. The sun you work on earth is done. Go to heaven to shout love for the Father and the Son. Oh, how we cried the day you left us together. I could see angels' faces when they hear your sweet voice sing. So go rest high on that mountain.
Pastor. This does conclude all services at this time. Once you're dismissed here, you may continue visiting, and I'm sure there's still plenty of good food in the other room. So thank you.